In this video, we are going to discuss about the inguinal canal anatomy. We'll be discussing about the boundaries of the inguinal canal and also the contents of the inguinal canal and some applied anatomy from this part. So before going into the details of the inguinal canal, what is this inguinal canal? So inguinal canal is a canal which is located in the inguinal region. So which is this inguinal region? Inguinal region is located in the region of groin, that is in the lower part of the abdominal wall. You are having the inguinal region nearly at the groin. So at the groin, you are having a canal, that is the inguinal canal. So what is this inguinal canal actually? It is an intermuscular space which is located in the lower abdominal wall. So you might have heard about the ligament, that is the inguinal ligament. So inguinal ligament, which I have drawn in this green color, is extending from the anterior superior iliac spine to the pubic tubercle on both sides. So this is the inguinal ligament you are seeing here. So this here you are seeing the abdominal wall. So this is the inguinal canal. And this inguinal canal is nothing but an intermuscular space which is related to the medial half of the inguinal ligament. So this is the medial half of the inguinal ligament. Above the medial half of the inguinal ligament, you are having a canal like this, okay? This canal, which is located just above the medial half of the inguinal ligament on both sides, is known as the inguinal canal. So inguinal canal is actually an intermuscular space, okay, located in the lower part of abdominal wall, anterior abdominal wall, okay, anterior abdominal wall. So that is in the region of groin, okay. It is located above medial half of inguinal ligament. So that is the location of the inguinal canal. So what is the length of this inguinal canal? It is 4 cm in length. So you can see that the inguinal canal has got two openings, one on the lateral side, one on the medial side. So which are these two openings? So we'll draw that. So on lateral side, you are able to see an opening here. This is nothing but this is the deep inguinal ring. So what is this? This is the deep inguinal ring, which is a lateral extent of the inguinal canal. Now the medial extent of the inguinal canal is nothing but a superficial inguinal ring. So superficial inguinal ring is located on the medial aspect of the inguinal canal. So inguinal canal extends from the deep inguinal ring on the lateral aspect to the superficial inguinal ring on the medial aspect. So what is this deep inguinal ring? It is actually a deficiency in the transversalis fascia. We know that the most posterior wall of the anterior abdominal wall is formed by the transversalis fascia. So it is the deepest one. So there is a deficiency in the transversalis fascia, which is known as the deep inguinal ring. So it is a circular opening in the transversalis fascia. It is actually deficiency in the transversalis fascia. So, and what is the location of the deep inguinal ring? This is very important. The deep inguinal ring is located 1.25 cm above the mid inguinal point. So this is the mid inguinal point, and the deep inguinal ring is situated 1.25 cm above the mid inguinal point. So that is all about the deep inguinal ring. So what is the superficial inguinal ring? The superficial inguinal ring is actually a triangular opening. It is triangular opening in the external oblique aponeurosis. Okay. It is a triangular opening in the external oblique aponeurosis. So, what is the location of the superficial inguinal ring? It is located just above the pubic tubercle of the pubic crest. Okay, that is the location. So, what is the inguinal canal? It is an intermuscular space which is located in the lower part of the anterior abdominal wall, especially in the groin region. And it is situated just above the medial half of the inguinal ligament, extending from the deep inguinal ring laterally to the superficial inguinal ring medially. What is the deep inguinal ring? It is a deficiency in the transversalis fissure. It is circular and is located 1.25 cm above the midinguinal point. And the superficial inguinal ring has a triangular opening in the external oblique aponeurosis, located just above the pubic tubercle. Okay. Now we'll go into the walls of the inguinal canal. So before studying the walls of the inguinal canal, you should have a basic idea about the muscles of the anterior abdominal wall. So in the muscles of the anterior abdominal wall, the superficial one is the external oblique muscle, and in the lower part, the external oblique aponeurosis. Now when the muscles are in aponeurosis here. So and deep to that, we are having the internal oblique muscle, and the deep to that we are having the transverse abdominis, and deep to the transverse abdominis you have the transversalis fissure. So that is the arrangement. This is the external oblique and this is the internal oblique, and this is the transverse abdominis, and deeper layer this is the transversalis fissure. You should have an idea about this. Now the external oblique in the lower part of the abdominal wall, it will be, so if this is the abdominal wall, so this is the external oblique muscle. In the lower part, the external oblique muscle forms an aponeurosis like this. So that is the external oblique, and the internal oblique fibers and the transverse abdominis deeper to that. That will, in the lower part of the anterior abdominal wall, it will arch like this near the groin, and the aponeurosis of both this joint together to form the conjoint tendon. So that is the conjoint tendon, which is formed by the internal oblique fibers and also the internal oblique and transverse abdominal. So this is the basic idea which you're going to have before discussing the walls of the inguinal canal. So most superficial one in the lower part is the external oblique aponeurosis, and deeper to that we are having the internal oblique transverse abdominis and transversalis fissure. And on the medial aspect, the aponeurosis of internal oblique and transverse abdominis joined together to form the conjoint tendon, which is located medially. Okay, that's the basic idea. Now we are going to discuss about the walls of the inguinal canal. So we are going to discuss the walls of the inguinal canal using a piece of paper here. We know that the inguinal canal is an intermuscular space which is located above the inguinal ligament. So if this is the inguinal ligament, it is like this, extending from the anterior superiliac spine to the pubic tubercle. And the inguinal canal, above the medial half of the inguinal ligament, you are having this canal like this. So it is located like this. So inguinal ligament is actually forming the floor of the inguinal canal. So from this diagram, the floor of the inguinal canal is formed by the inguinal ligament. That is, the medial half of the inguinal ligament will form the floor. So the floor is being formed by the grooved upper surface of medial half of inguinal ligament. Okay. Now, what is the anterior wall? We'll discuss about that now. So far we have discussed that the anterior most structure in the lower part of the anterior abdominal wall was the external oblique aponeurosis arising from the external oblique muscle. So the external oblique muscle will form the anterior wall of the inguinal ligament. This is the external oblique aponeurosis. Okay, this external oblique aponeurosis actually arising from the external oblique muscle is located in the lower part of the anterior abdominal wall, and it passes downwards and it is winding around the inguinal ligament like this. So the anterior wall of the inguinal canal is being formed by the external oblique aponeurosis in the entire extent. So if the inguinal ligament is located like this, The external oblique upper neurosis is passing under the inguinal ligament and passing like this. Okay, so the anterior wall is formed by which structure? External oblique upper neurosis in the entire extent. So the anterior wall is formed in the entire extent by the external oblique upper neurosis. Okay, there is also another structure, we'll discuss about it later. And we know that this external oblique is lying like this, and the posterior most structure we are having in the lower part of the anterior abdominal wall is nothing but the transversalis fascia. Transversalis fascia is located posteriorly. So the transversalis fascia, you can see that in between the external oblique anteriorly and transversalis fascia here, you are able to see a canal located just above the medial half of the inguinal ligament. So this canal is the inguinal canal. So the posterior wall is formed in the entire extent by which fascia? That is the transversalis fascia. So posterior wall is formed in the entire extent by the transversalis fascia. So far we have discussed about the floor, anterior wall, and also the posterior wall. So there is also a roof to this structure. So we'll lie this like this. Okay. The anterior wall is formed by the external oblique, posterior wall is formed by the transversalis fascia, the inguinal ligament is forming the floor. So we'll keep it like this. Okay. Now we are going to discuss about the structures which are other structures which are forming the anterior wall, posterior wall, and also the roof of the inguinal canal. So we know that besides the external oblique muscle, there are also other muscles in the anterior abdominal wall. Which are they? That is the internal oblique and transverse oblique. So, and in this groin region, the internal oblique and the transverse abdominis is arranged like this. So we can see I have marked the internal oblique here. And internal oblique, the fibers of the internal oblique arches like this on the topmost part of the inguinal canal. So the fibers of internal oblique from the lateral aspect, it goes upwards and arches over the inguinal canal like this. So along with the internal oblique, you can see the fibers of the transverse abdominis is also arching over the topmost part of the inguinal canal. So the fibers of internal oblique and transverse abdominis are forming the roof of the inguinal canal. Now the external the upper neurosis of these two muscles, that is the internal oblique and transverse abdominis, they join together on the medial aspect, which is known as the conjoint tendon. So what happens to this conjoint tendon? It winds like this, and the conjoint tendon is attached to the posterior wall. So if you see the conjoint tendon is attached to the posterior wall of the inguinal canal. So what is the arrangement of the internal oblique? Laterally you can see the internal oblique over the anterior wall of the inguinal canal, and when going upwards you can see the fibers of transverse abdominis and internal oblique arching over the inguinal canal, and on medial aspect these fibers join together to form the conjoint tendon, which get inserted, so which goes posteriorly and get inserted. So you can see that on the lateral aspect of the inguinal canal, the anterior wall is formed by the internal oblique fibers, and on the medial aspect the posterior wall is also formed by the conjoint tendon besides the transversalis fascia. And the roof of the inguinal canal is important, which is formed by the arching fibers of the internal oblique and transverse abdominis. So from this you can see that the anterior wall is formed in the entire extent by the external oblique aponeurosis, but on the lateral aspect you can see the internal oblique also forming the anterior wall here. So it is also formed by the internal oblique. Anterior wall is also formed by internal oblique fibers on lateral aspect. Of the inguinal canal. So, and we have seen that the conjoint tendon is forming the posterior wall on the medial aspect. So, the posterior wall is formed in the entire extent by the transversalis fascia, but on the medial aspect it is also formed by the conjoint tendon. So, it is also formed by posterior wall is also formed by conjoint tendon. So, cartilage conjoint tendon, it is formed by the merging of aponeurosis of internal oblique and transverse abdomen. It's conjoint tendon on the medial aspect. And the roof is very important. We have seen the roof, this is the roof which is formed by the arching fibers of transverse abdominis and internal oblique. So, roof is formed by arching fibers of internal oblique and transverse abdominis. So that is all about the walls of the inguinal canal. So the floor is formed by the inguinal ligament, that is the medial half of the inguinal ligament. The anterior wall is formed in the extension by the external oblique aponeurosis and also laterally by the internal oblique fibers. And the posterior wall you see here is formed by the transversalis fascia in the entire extent and on the medial aspect by the conjoint tendon. And the roof is formed by the arching fibers of transverse abdominis and internal oblique. So that is all about the walls of the inguinal canal. So we are discussing about the contents of the inguinal canal. So there is a slight difference of contents in between the males and females. So we'll discuss separately the contents in contents of inguinal canal in males and females. Now we know that this is the inguinal ligament. So this is the inguinal ligament, and above the medial half of the inguinal ligament, extending from the deep inguinal ring to the superficial inguinal ring, you are having the inguinal canal here. So, and we know that there are some structures which pass from the abdomen through the deep inguinal ring and through the superficial inguinal ring to the scrotum in males. And there are some structures which pass from the abdomen to the deep inguinal ring to the superficial inguinal ring and to the which gets attached to the labia majora in females. So which are these structures? The important structure in males that passes from the deep inguinal ring to the superficial inguinal ring through the inguinal canal is the vas deferens. So in males, the important structure is it is the spermaticoid, not vas deferens, it is a spermaticoid. So spermaticoid in males passes through the deep inguinal ring to the inguinal canal and to the superficial inguinal ring and reach the scrotal like this. So important structure in males is the spermaticoid. And the spermaticoid consists of certain coverings. The coverings of the spermaticoid includes an external spermatic fascia, which is derived from the external oblique aponeurosis. There is an internal spermatic fascia. Okay. And there is a cremastric fascia. Internal spermatic fascia is derived from the internal oblique aponeurosis, and the cremastric fascia. Sorry for the mistake here. There is outer layer is formed by this. So external spermatic fascia, which is derived from the external oblique aponeurosis, and inner to that we are having the cremastric fascia, which is derived from the internal oblique aponeurosis, and deeper to that we are having the internal spermatic fascia. And the internal spermatic fascia is derived from the transversalis fascia. Okay, transversalis fascia. So these are the coverings of the spermaticoid from the outer to inner region, that is external spermatic fascia, cremastric fascia, internal spermatic fascia. External spermatic fascia is formed from the external oblique aponeurosis, cremastric fascia from the internal oblique, and internal spermatic fissure from the transocelous fissure. And we will discuss about the spermatic cord in detail and the contents in detail. I'll just mention the contents of the spermatic cord. It consists of vas deferens, okay, vas deferens, artery to the vas, okay. It consists of testicular artery. Okay, it consists of some veins which is called the papiniform plexus of veins. And it also consists of cremastric artery. And it also consists of a remnant of processes vaginalis. And also some autonomic nerves, nerve plexus and lymphatics. So the important structures to the spermatic cord are the vas deferens, artery to vas deferens, testicular artery, papiniform plexus of veins, remnant of processes vaginalis, cremastric artery and autonomic plexus of nerves and lymphatics. So besides this, there is an important nerve which is passing through the spermatic cord, which is that nerve. So in the spermatic cord, there is an important nerve which is known as a genital branch of genitofemoral nerve. So this is another content of the spermatic cord, genital branch of genitofemoral nerve. So overall, you can see that the one important content of this inguinal canal in males is the spermatic cord. So which is the other structure, second structure which is present in males. And there is one nerve which is entering the inguinal canal from the roof of the inguinal canal like this. It goes like this. So that nerve is known as the ilioinguinal nerve. So ilioinguinal nerve, it doesn't actually pass through the deep inguinal ring into the inguinal canal. So it is entering the inguinal canal from its roof. By piercing the roof, it comes into the inguinal canal. So ilioinguinal nerve is also a content of the inguinal canal in males. Ilioinguinal nerve. So which are the two main contents of the inguinal canal in males? So in males, the two contents of the inguinal canal are the spermatic cord with its contents and also the ilioinguinal nerve. So for completion's sake, I have just mentioned about the contents of the spermatic cord, and the main contents are ilioinguinal nerve and the spermatic cord in males. So which are the structures passing through the inguinal canal in females? In females, there is a structure which is known as the round ligament. So the round ligament in females is a structure which is passing from the corner of the uterus, and it is passing through the deep inguinal ring to the inguinal canal, and it gets attached to the labium majora. So this structure which is attached, it is from the corner of the uterus, passes through deep inguinal ring, passes through the inguinal canal, emerges out through the superficial inguinal ring to get attached into the labia majora. That is known as the round ligament. So round ligament of uterus is an important content of the inguinal canal in females. So I am mentioning in females. So the contents of the inguinal canal in males and females is different, slightly different. So in females also, you are having a nerve which is piercing the inguinal canal from its roof. That is known as the ilioinguinal nerve. So ilioinguinal nerve is a common content of the inguinal canal in males and females. So ilioinguinal nerve also forms the content of inguinal canal. Note that the ilioinguinal nerve doesn't pass through the deep inguinal ring, but instead it enters the inguinal canal by piercing its roof. So even though it is a content of the inguinal canal, it is not passing through the deep inguinal ring. So ilioinguinal nerve. And the third structure is, there is an artery to round ligament. So artery to the round ligament is a branch of inferior epigastric artery. It also passes through the part. And there is, we have said that as a content of the spermatocode, we had a genital branch of genitofemoral nerve. In females also, this nerve is present. But the difference is that in this females, it is not enclosed in the spermatocode, unlike in males. The males are having spermatocode and the genital branch of genitofemoral nerve is enclosed in the spermatocode in males. But in females, it is passing through the inguinal canal like this. Okay, so it is also forming a content of the inguinal canal in females, that is the genital branch of genitofemoral nerve. And besides this, a remnant of the processes, fibrous remnants of the processes vaginalis can also be seen in females. So these are the structures passing through the inguinal canal in females. So what is the difference here? In males, you are having the contents as the important structure passing through the inguinal canal in males is the spermatocode. And the spermatocode consists of three coverings: external spermatic fascia, acromastic fascia, and internal spermatic fascia. And as the contents of the spermatocode, you are having the vas deferens, artery to the vas deferens, testicular artery, cremastric artery, papiniform plexus of veins, and you are having the remnants of the processus vaginalis and one nerve which is known as the genital branch of genitofemoral nerve. So if you are asked the important contents passing through the inguinal canal in males, just say the spermatocode with its contents and the ilioinguinal nerve. And in females, the round ligament of the uterus is passing through the inguinal canal. That is the important structure in females. And females also, you are having the ilioinguinal nerve, which is piercing the roof of the inguinal canal and forming a content of the inguinal canal. And the genital branch of the genitofemoral nerve is again forming the content of the inguinal canal in females also. So in females, important structures are round ligament of the uterus, ilioinguinal nerve, and the genital branch of genitofemoral nerve, and artery to the round ligament, which is the branch of inferior epigastric artery. And you can see the remnant of the fibrous remnant of the processus vaginalis here also. So important contents are round ligament and ilioinguinal nerve and the genital branch of the genitofemoral nerve. So that is all about the inguinal canal. And if you are asked about the applied anatomy, so the importance of clinical importance of the inguinal canal in the surgical field is the condition known as the inguinal hernia. So you might have heard about a inguinal hernia, which is a common condition. So what is this hernia actually? Hernia is a protrusion of the peritoneal sac with or without a contained viscous through any weakness in the abdominal wall. So So that is the definition of a hernia, simple definition of a hernia. So if this hernia occurs, that is the protrusion of the peritoneal sac with or without the contained viscous occurs through the inguinal canal, it is known as an inguinal hernia. So inguinal hernia is any herniation of the peritoneal sac with or without its contained viscous through the inguinal canal. So why it happens usually in the inguinal canal? Because the inguinal canal is one of the common site of weakness in the anterior abdominal wall. So one of the common site of weakness in the anterior abdominal wall is the inguinal region. So most often the some contents of the peritoneal, so some peritoneal sac may protrude out through the inguinal canal here. So that is known as the inguinal hernia. So we have seen that this is the deep inguinal ring, okay, which is situated 1.25 centimeter above the inguinal point. And medially you are having the superficial inguinal ring. So some hernias may pass through the deep inguinal ring and pass through the inguinal canal and pass through the superficial inguinal ring and comes, it may stay here or it comes out into the scrotum like this. So those hernias which pass from the deep inguinal ring to the superficial inguinal ring, as these are, these emerge, those hernias which are emerging from the deep inguinal ring and pass through the inguinal canal to the superficial inguinal ring like this, these are known as the indirect inguinal hernia. So these are the indirect inguinal hernias. But there are some hernias which do not come from the deep inguinal ring, but these emerges medial to the deep inguinal ray. So if this is a deep inguinal ray, this comes out through a weakness in the posterior abdominal wall like this, medial to the deep inguinal ring, and it passes like this. So these hernias, which directly emerge from the posterior abdominal wall, medial to the deep inguinal ring, are known as the direct inguinal hernia. So inguinal hernias are of two types. These can be indirect inguinal hernia and also direct inguinal hernias. So how do this inguinal hernias usually present? It usually presents as mass or swelling in the groin region. So a swelling in the groin region. So this can either stay in the inguinal region alone, or it can come out into the scrotum. It can also present as a scrotal swelling. So what is the peculiarity of this inguinal hernia swelling? This will usually give an expansal impulse of coughing. Okay, expansal impulse of coughing is a characteristic feature of this inguinal hernia. So what is this? When you ask the patient to cough, the size of the swelling may increase. It gives an expansive impulse on coughing, and if you touch the swelling and ask the patient to cough, there will be an expansive impulse and there will be enlargement of the swelling. And so that is the difference with coughing. And so sometimes if the patient with the swelling is asked to lie in supine position, the swelling may disappear or it reduces in size. Or if the patient can himself reduce the swelling by pushing it upward. So reducibility can also be a sign. So it can be reducible. Sometimes in some stages, the hernias can turn into irreducible hernias also. Anyway, reducibility is one of the common features. And that is all about the rough idea of the inguinal hernia. So inguinal hernias usually present as a swelling in the groin region. So it can also present as a scrotal swelling. So this can be a direct inguinal hernia or indirect inguinal hernia. What is the clinical presentation of swelling in the groin region? The pain can sometimes occur. And when the patient lifts some weight also, the swelling may increase because of the increased intra-abdominal pressure. So when the patient lies in supine position or push the lesion upwards, it may reduce in size while the patient coughs. So what happens with coughing? While coughing, the intra-abdominal pressure increases and the size of the swelling increases. So expansive impulse on cough is one of the characteristic features of the inguinal hernia. So that is all about the applied anatomy of the inguinal canal. So that is all about the inguinal canal. Thank you for watching this video. To see more videos from our channel, please subscribe the channel. Thank you.